Recording is on.
So welcome everybody. So we will start the next lecture in the series after the lockdown. So I have already shared the application window with you, where the slides are there. This is the same one which I had circulated also on the group, so that you could actually have gone through it before coming to the lecture. Okay, so last time what we had discussed was spillover. Okay, in that case kindly mute your microphone. Okay, so later on, whenever you have a question, that time you can unmute and ask. So last time we had discussed spillover technique, specifically in quad DHT, because that was using asymmetric distance. Okay, so every time it was always possible to find out a node which is closest to you. It will never be the one which has actually sent you the request. It will be always be the next one, and then you can actually ask him to essentially store it, and then if he cannot do it, he can further forward it to the next guy. So everybody just going to maintain a table, spillover table. Only thing which need to now change is we have to have two modes of routing. The first one will be with DHT and second one will be the spillover routing. So we will still be using a spillover technique, but this is a second method and which can be used even in a symmetric situation. So now the question which comes here, if DHT is done with a symmetric distance, so node A is B is closer to A, so maybe the way we did it last time, so you will hand over the query to B. Okay, or basically you will publish it with B, so queries will also be handed over to B from A to B. But then what happens when B is running short of space, again A is the closest guy, it will always ask A, assuming that A will further find out who is the next closer person. So A will ultimately again will ask B. So this will keep on happening back and forth and things cannot work. So we need to modify this. So first of all, we'll modify the spillover table. We'll introduce back the node ID. So range of hash ID and the corresponding node ID. So that will be the first modification which has to be done. And next is, so now when there is no space on the root, at the root node, what should be done actually? So now we are going to change it here. It's not the closest node. Now the query will be sent to all the nodes in the routing table. Okay. And so it means if you are a node, you might be getting the requests for storage from the other nodes who must be maintaining your node ID in their routing table. So when a node gets such a request, it should respond back and telling that how much storage space is available with it. Okay, so this request essentially will be going back, and root node will get now a list of nodes from which it has to select. Okay, so basically it will be kind of your routing table is done in such a way as a logarithmic partitioning. Okay, within your own domain, you will be having everybody. Then as a domain, as you actually keep on going down, your domain size will become larger and larger. We have been using logarithmic routing. So this can be done parallelly or sequentially or a few at a time. There can be three possibilities. So you can try with N1. N1 says, I don't have a space. It can go with N2 and so on. Okay, when everybody is over, then things are over. So probably we might have to figure out, invent a mechanism of doing broadcasting. So all three modes can be used. Of course, I am assuming it to be done parallelly. Okay, the middle one, the first one. So we'll do it parallel to everybody and let the responses come back. How it will be done, I will tell. And once the nodes will respond back, So R can choose from these whatever responses have come, the closest one. Okay, that could be the criteria. And you make an entry in the spillover table. How it will be done, I will tell. Okay, and so it will say for this range, I need to send the request to this particular guy. Okay, so it's not the closest or the backup route node in the way we have discussed earlier. So now how the range will be partitioned, that's a question. So this partitioning can be done based on the available space at the root node. So this available space, basically the space which is being used by root is total space which is available, which also includes already occupied one. And the available free space on the responding node, because that's what you are going to use from them. So depending on this, the ratio which you have of the spaces available with all the nodes, you can partition your SID range accordingly. So this kind of create a uniform loading. Okay. Because we assume all my published requests will be coming equally distributed across the hash ID space. Okay. So take a case here that when the root node is connected to R1, R2, and R3. So root node is responsible for the node IDs, hash IDs 20 to 60. And it is short of space. Okay, it had only 50 MB, but now 50 MB is getting consumed. Now remember, some of the things which have already been stored on 50 MB will now also be transferred to R1, R2, R3 now. So now R1 responds that it can provide you 10 megabyte. I have not written the units here, but you can add. So 10 megabytes can be put in. R2 says I am going to give you 40 MB. R3 says 50 MB. So in this case, I will do the partitioning. So for example, in this case, if you look at, I have to do 40 megabyte is 40 is the your total range which is available. So I have 50, 50 and 50, total 150 MB which is there. So 150 by 40. Okay, sorry. So 40 by 150 essentially I have to do. So I can do 40 by 15, which roughly turns out to be 13 point something. Okay. So I will be using a 13 block, can go for 50 MB block. So based on that, essentially I can say 20 to 33 will go to itself, because this is a total hash ID range of 40 multiplied by 50 divided by 150. I am just approximated. Similarly, from 34 again, 13 will go to R3. R3 has given a capacity of 50 MB actually. So roughly same 13 hash ID range will be going to it. And then the remaining one be divided according to the whatever they were actually contributing. So that remaining, it will be actually 14. 14 will be split across R1 and R2. Okay. And this maps can be many possible ways this can be done. So we can leave it to the node, depending on they can order it in node ID and then give the partitioning or the larger ones first and the smaller ones later. So this is what actually has been done here, larger ones first and smaller ones later actually. Okay, but it's hardly immaterial. So this is another possible map which you can create. Say 20 to 30 has been given to R2. Which was 10, so which was, again here it was 10 range was given. So the range will remain the same, but who starts after whom, that can be changed. So this is also going to function, this can be anything arbitrary. Now the question is, this is what we call proxy route. So in the previous lecture, what I did was also proxy routes. So what will happen when a proxy route itself actually runs out of this space? So it essentially has to inform the R that it is running out of the space. There is no space available. So root node now should initiate the query again for storage providers. It will again do the broadcast. And those who have space will respond back. Those who don't will not respond back. And based on the responses, R will make the new partition of the hash ID range, enter them in the spillover table. Old entries will still be maintained because there are still key value pairs with the older proxy routes, which has to move to these new values, actually, new nodes, which have now been decided in the spillover table. So I will still keep this entry. And there will be an expiry time for this. This expiry time has to be large enough so that the republication of key value pairs can be done by all the proxy routes. So they will go to the right place based on the new spillover table. And then because they are not going to be replenished back, so they will essentially purge from there and they will free up the space. Okay. So as we know that all nodes will be republishing key value pairs. That's now essentially is a feature in our design which we have come up. So redistribution will happen for all key value pairs in a certain time. So old entries from spillover table will expire after some time. We will have a new nodes which are now going to hold. That's how the shortage of space at the proxy routes will be taken care of. Now there is another issue which will come up, that whenever you will do republishing, okay, it can actually create a traffic storm. And this will be unnecessarily large management traffic which may be present actually in that case. So we can actually think of a situation if a key value pair entry need not migrate. So for example, a proxy route figures out that is a republishing time. Okay, so it first of all sends a message back. Okay, so we essentially, it only sends a message the timer is expiring for this entry. This is the key value. You let me know whether it is going to be assigned back to me or it will be republished to somebody else. So in case it has to be go to the same node, it will simply say that you just reset your timer. So there is no actual transfer of key value pair which will be happening. If it is has to be published somewhere else, in that case a message can come back. No republish is required. You kindly send all key value pairs through a republish mechanism. It will come back to the root node because of DHCP routing, and then again from there the spillover routing will be happening and it will go to some other place. This will typically will be happening whenever the proxy routes are running out of space or reorganization has to be done. So for example, now R1, if at R1 the key value timer expires, it will send a message to R regarding hash range for which the timer is expiring. Okay. So R will then send the reset timer message if the same node is supposed to hold the key value pair. If it is supposed to hold a different range, maybe a smaller part of that range, it will only tell that. So remaining key value pairs will be republished. So it can be partial or it can be full republishing, which may be permitted. So R1 will then send all key value pairs for republishing through DHT routing, or it can be done directly. So directly, I think, is a more preferred thing. It is more efficient, actually, because you will be now saving on the amount of traffic which is going to move in the network. So now the issue is how you will find out the nodes who can give the storage space. So I told you so far that you send the request to all the nodes in its routing table. But if all the nodes in the routing table are already short of space, then what is going to happen? So normally you can actually, the way it should be done is, it's a broadcast scenario which has to be used. The message should actually have a TTL, time to live value, basically number of hops. Every time you forward, you reduce this number. When this number becomes zero, you no more do the forwarding. Okay, I think it's being incorrectly written as incremented. It should be decremented every time a broadcast message is sent. So my apologies for that. So you may note down the correction. So slides have already been circulated. So in that, actually, you can make the correction. Or I will also correct and then update, re-update it actually. Okay. So now every node, so as a node, you must be in the routing table of a lot of other people. So you will be receiving broadcast messages. So you will make an entry that this broadcast message has come from source node. So this I am using same broadcast routing which we teach when teaching OSPF, Open Shortest Path First Routing Algorithm. So you will, there is a source node entry which will be there. There is a sequence number which will be present. Okay, so every time this sequence number has to be incremented whenever you are going to send a broadcast value. And there is always a timer also you will be sending. This timer has to be stored in the table. So every node will maintain a broadcast routing table. If there is no entry in this, it will make the entry in the source entry for the source node and sequence number here, and it will also add the timer. Okay, so because entry was not there, so it was the first packet broadcast which has been received. So you will essentially now simply rebroadcast this thing to all other nodes except from where you have received it. Okay, and this timer will start. Whenever this timer actually expires, that time this particular table entry will be removed. Okay, so if the timer has not expired, you get a new thing and it contains a sequence number which is smaller or equal to the already available sequence number, then it must be a duplicate packet. You have to simply discard it. Okay, if the sequence number is higher, you have to update all these entries in the broadcast routing table and forward the packet to or message to all other nodes except from the incoming one. So on your routing table. So it's kind of a tree. Remember, within very short, because number of nodes may not be very large. Okay, so number of nodes, if I am using 256-bit hash ID, in worst case, 256 hops will be required and you will be able to reach to everybody in the broadcast routing. So you give a TTL of 1, find out if you can get some nodes which can actually give you the storage. Otherwise, give a TTL of 2, you will get more responses back and so on, till you get sufficient number and then you can distribute your storage in that. So I'm assuming as of now that every node is working honestly. Okay, so this, if nodes are working dishonestly, I will be taking up that thing sometime later. So if the entry is the same thing, if the entry exists in this routing table, you receive the message, forward it after reducing the TTL, is a decreasing, which I mentioned earlier, and only if the sequence number of the message is more than what is maintained in the routing table. If the TTL becomes zero, simply discard the packet. You don't have to retransmit this thing anymore. Okay, if this sequence number is lower than or equal to whatever is stored, this must be a duplicate. Simply drop the message. Okay, this ensures there is a kind of a broadcast which happens and there are no duplicates being retransmitted. A duplicate might be received, they are never transmitted again. Now the question is, why a node should contribute its storage? I am assuming that everybody is very honest, so they will be doing it. So everybody is not altruistic, so everybody is not going to contribute. If they are rational users, they will not be. So system defined so far will function pretty well if everybody is cooperative. Otherwise, it may not function actually. Now, if the nodes start doing free riding, typically what it means is they don't contribute any storage, but they start using the storage of others. The guy who is genuinely contributing, he essentially is losing anything, he's not getting anything actually. Ideally speaking, what you contribute, the same thing you should get back. Okay, so this is was the second technique which I thought I would be discussing today. This I have discussed, and we will be now looking into next time. There is another technique of redistributing the load across the nodes. This is by actually changing what we call the weights. So weights of the node. Earlier, I have already shared this thing in the notes. I figured out there was one problem that all the hash IDs. So if a hash ID is equal to a node ID, that node ID is going to have to store it, irrespective of whether he has a storage or not. Okay, for others, I think it can be passed on to some other nodes depending on the weight function. So I will talk about that technique, and maybe I will also talk about how to take care of this free riding situation. So notes have already been shared, you can go through them. So I will prepare the slides and then we will have the next interesting session. So any questions you have so far? So with that, actually, the presentation ends. So any question from anybody? So anyway, if you don't have a question now, but later on you find something you are not clear, you can simply put the message in the Telegram, and then there I will then respond to that. So with that, thank you very much for coming online even today, when it's actually is a gazetted holiday, but because of lockdown, every day is a holiday actually nowadays. So probably in a day or two again, we'll have another interesting session where I will be discussing about free riding, as well as the another technique of distributing the storage load across the nodes. Thank you very much.